I've been an investigative reporter and a journalist for 35 years. I've worked in every major media market in the United States, and I've written for more than 100 newspapers and magazines nationally and internationally. So last September 17th, I became the first journalist in U.S. history to go to the U.S. National Archives and the Library of Congress and pore over the thousands of pages of documents in both places to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt or any refutation of the facts that Prescott Bush, the grandfather of George W. Bush, and George Herbert Walker, his maternal great-grandfather for whom his daddy is named, were Nazi traitors to the country who should have been tried for treason. 2 weeks ago, in early August, a major world newspaper, The Guardian of London, finally got on the story internationally, and they flew a renowned reporter of theirs named Duncan Campbell over to Washington to take me back to the archives and Library of Congress so that they could verify that these explosive documents were real and I didn't have forged copies. Prescott Bush was the grandfather of George W. Bush and the father of George Herbert Walker Bush, and George Herbert Walker Bush is named for his father-in-law, George Herbert Walker. Prescott Bush graduated from Yale in 1917 and was in Skull and Bones with E. Roland Harriman, who was the younger brother of W. Averill Harriman. So he brought Prescott Bush first into Brown Brothers Harriman and then Union Banking Corporation. In actuality, it was anything but a bank. It was essentially a Nazi money laundering operation that had a lot of tentacles into a lot of different other businesses. They owned a shipping line called Hamburg American Line, for example, which was the first Nazi front business seized, although the line was no longer operational in 1942. In the early 1930s, it transported Nazi spies into the U.S., and then their promotional ads offered cash rewards to any American citizens who would go back on Hamburg American Lines and proselytize for Hitler. 8 months after the U.S. had entered the war, the New York Herald Tribune ran a front page article, "Hitler's Angel has 3 million in U.S. bank." And it caused a major scandal and just rocked the world of politics. Brown Brothers Harriman, which George Herbert Walker and Prescott Bush were affiliated with and partners in, worked with IG Farben, which operated Auschwitz. Prescott Bush, he did a number of things that were not only anti-American, but were pro-Hitler, and he did all that he could to proselytize for Hitler and the rise of his Third Reich, because the largest client, Fritz Thyssen, of his patron, W. Averill Harriman, dictated what kind of behavior he would practice to enhance his own career. So he was put on the board of directors of Union Banking Corporation, and he was also a shareholder in Union Banking Corporation along with E. Roland Harriman. August 9th, had to do with the hearings of the McCormick-Dickstein Committee of November 1934. Show that Prescott Bush and the DuPont family, the Remington family, and J.P. Morgan tried to overthrow the U.S. government, assassinate FDR, and put a Hitler-style fascist state in place. I have in my possession testimony from the McCormick-Dickstein Committee in November of 1934 by one of the fascist plotters that they were going to follow Hitler's model exactly and impose martial law on the United States, round up unemployed people that were worthless to the economy and troublemakers and Jews and put them into internment camps. And their plan was, if necessary, to exterminate the people that could not be part of the effort. The only reason the coup attempt in 1934 didn't succeed is that they hired the wrong general to lead it, General Smedley Butler, the great Marine hero, two-time Congressional Medal of Honor winner, who worked with the plotters just long enough to be able to identify who they were and then blew the whistle on them to Congress. Incredibly, after being warned by the FBI and the Justice Department and the Treasury Department to cease and desist in their Nazi dealings, they had continued them until 1951. There had been 28 additional seizures of Nazi assets and Nazi business fronts between late 1942 and 1951, and that they had moved Nazi assets into Switzerland, Brazil, Argentina, and Panama, and they had continued to do business with their primary Nazi patron, who was Fritz Thyssen, who backed Hitler beginning in 1921 and who was the wealthiest man in Germany, and a steel and coal baron who, with his partner Friedrich Flick, essentially built the Nazi war machine along with IG Farben. In 1951, now you look at the Republican National Convention this week and you bring in Arnold Schwarzenegger to speak last night. Schwarzenegger is the son of a Nazi. He has praised Nazis. He has praised Hitler. He talked last night in terms like, we will not falter, we will not waver, we will win this war on terror.
He's a leader who doesn't flinch, who doesn't waver, and does not back down.
Well, that's exactly the speeches that Hitler made after the Reichstag fire. Terrorism and the homeland being under attack are precisely the issues that Hitler used to subvert everything within the German system of government. This is a criminal regime. They not only emulate Hitler, but its genesis comes from Hitler. And I defy anyone, a historian, journalist, author, anyone, to come forward and disprove my premise that you cannot differentiate Hitler's invasion of Poland in 1939 and the Reichstag fire and his attempt to dominate the world from George W. Bush's unprovoked invasion of Iraq and subversion of the Constitution through the Patriot Act after 9/11, which I submit is his Reichstag fire.